Hi, everyone. Thanks for putting up with that. Who knows how long of me babbling.
I appreciate
you. Hey, no problem. I thought we ought to wait until traffic has been bad for some people, and some of them like to drag in at a certain time. And there's my OCD and obsessive punctuality aside, I'm happy to be here with you guys today. My name is John Lee Clemmer. I work for IBM Cloud Identity Services. I'm a managing consultant. Cloud Identity Services is what we're going to talk about today. Again, this is a sales and pre-sales presentation that the guys in that side of the department did, and it's the first time I've done this presentation, so bear with me for some of it. I wanted to see what they're telling the customers based on what I've done with the large enterprises I work with. I thought this would be a great way to get into it, is to do this for you guys, and hopefully you'll find some things that are interesting and exciting for you in that. Cloud Identity Services, not everyone is necessarily aware of what's available, what's possible, and the direction that the industry might or might not be going, depending on your perspective. We'll talk a good bit about that. I do want to thank Dan, who prepared these slides. And looks like he did a great job. I hadn't seen it before I thought I would do the presentation. And when I looked through them, I said, that's a very good representation of what we do technically and what's available. So first we'll talk about trends. Traditionally, with identity and access management, I've given a couple of presentations about federation before and how that works historically and what we've done now on the web. And you'll see in here how things are rapidly evolving and we're changing the way that users and their identities work with each other, with different organizations, within organizations, across the internet. The traditional view is very tech. IT departments traditionally have been very siloed, have their own idea of things as a technical solution, and not really a business solution or enterprise solution. They looked at identity and access management as a tool just for policy enforcement. Can we use this tool, suite of tools or techniques to just enforce policy? And they'd also look at it, hey, we've got to get something in place for this or that, you know, portal, Oracle suite, these other things, and so we have a project to do it. It's like, we've got to bolt this stuff in, get it on there, for whether it's compliance, security audit, whatever reason that you'll see comes up. They looked at it in the past traditionally. This is a thing we have to do. You can do it as a project. They also looked at it as a cost of doing business. A lot of you guys are using security that are in the field, and those that aren't. If you work for a business, you have to deal with the security department. Traditionally, managers looked at that and said, this is just something we have to do. We don't really get anything out of it. Is there a cost to doing business? They didn't look at it as something strategic or a differentiator for their businesses at all. And traditionally, if you needed somebody for that, a lot of things were on-premise, and that's changed a lot in the last decade, that almost all the core line of business software was on-premise. You'd buy a license, you'd have to hire somebody to do the work for that. You'd get, I've got to have the database woman for this, I've got to have the security guy for this, I've got to have the person that knows directory, the person that knows whatever the particular software is. And so people were hiring in some fairly expensive talent, a lot of these things, especially with IDM, it's a narrow and broad set of tools and techniques that if you haven't done it for a long time, there's a learning curve. Anybody who's done a lot of administration and network design and architecture and deployment for different apps could do it, but you're asking someone to have that job and just go do that. I wouldn't put an administrator or someone on, here you go, you're responsible for all the stuff you do now, plus these applications, plus the security tools and suites to manage them. They'd be like a security department, and you start having, there's not an economy of scale there. That's what they found. So there's the modern view, where you've got these pieces there for federation, for user lifecycle management, and all the security and access controls for that. You know, that's coming in as something strategic. See now, compliance and audit pieces, they say, hey, we've got to have some unified way to do this, to get reporting, we've got to know what's going on, if we need to do a point check or something because of an incident. So I have it there for intelligence and compliance. And they look at IBM and IBM now as something strategic as a business differentiator. And with more and more services being provided through the internet and web as a service, and it's something that you buy out as a license and don't have on-premise, you've got to have something that works on the cloud, on the internet. The cloud is what we call it if you're selling things to people. The challenges that IBM has found with traditional on-premise, I've talked about some of that. If you've got to find something that works with all your different line of business applications and things you have online, there can be constrained budgets. Hey, we've already paid for a license for, you know, Outlook Exchange, for SAP, for Oracle. You know, now you're telling me we've got to buy these other tools and services to go on top of it. You got a constrained budget. And you've got, obviously, the projects we're doing. Those things don't stand still. For all these different pieces and software that you've got, they've got their own timelines for enterprises. It's a very big amount of effort that goes behind the deployments to constantly keeping them upgraded, yada, 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 new version. You know, trying to get those things lined up on these different schedules can be complex. As I mentioned in the previous slide, the difficulty in getting the skill set. Generally, those people, once you get to a certain point in that skill set within an organization, you end up with there's a salary cap where you pay somebody the amount that it would take to keep them around or something. They say, hey, you know, last time I checked, people were really, this was really in demand. I think I'd like to go somewhere else. And we know that's the case for any high-end skill set in IT. Once you get to a certain level of expertise, you know, right now there's negative unemployment for that. People will be calling all the time saying, hey, do you have this or that skill set? Do you know anybody? Which is a great place to be in IT at the moment. As I mentioned a few minutes ago, falling behind on product versions, having to constantly do upgrades and patches and things with it. An organization has, you know, one more suite of tools and techniques they've got to keep up at that latest patch level to stay away from the vulnerabilities. And again, integrating things quickly. I can hammer this up all day. That's a pain to be to put something in place. If they had, you know, hey, we've got an initiative from a C-level person. I want this stuff in place. Well, if you want to get everything ramped up on an internal project and get the resources in and possibly hire somebody, as I keep saying, that's expensive. It's difficult to do it. And of course, then you're telling your operations people I talked about in the previous slide, hey, here's this new thing that's really complicated and deals with crucial strategic security. You guys have to manage it now. Here you go. All these consultants and people came in, contractors, and made this thing is connected to all your stuff. Have fun managing it. You're welcome. Don't mind these 10,000 alerts that showed up in your inbox. So what we see, obviously there's an advantage if you say, I want to outsource that as a service and have someone else manage all of it out on the cloud, and we'll see some of the reasons why. The demand for those services, any kind of software as a service, is growing due to those things I just talked about. There's pressure to reduce the complexity on premise. There's pressure to not have to, again, manage all the hassles talked about. And it looks like the figures that Dan's come up with by 2019, the identity access manager purchases are going to use the identity as a service survey model on 10%. I really seen an enormous awareness in terms of people working with federation with remote identity management over the years. Years become just insane the amount of action there.
One thing we didn't talk about initially, but I
often do in the access federation talks before, is what is an identity? What do we mean by that? You know, is that just a user account? What's different about that on identity as an abstract concept? And what we've got there in that enterprise ecosystem for the user is just like you're an end user. You've got lots of different accounts. You've got lots of different accounts. You've got a Twitter account, another email account. If you don't use emails in one place, maybe you've got other services, Box or Drive or whatever. There's a lot of connected there.
And for an individual,
certainly you've got a set of problems and challenges dealing with that. For the enterprise,
they're looking at, hey, my
salespeople have to be connected to Salesforce. They've got to be connected to Twitter for those sales pitches they want to make. They've got to be connected on Facebook, handle requests about products and services. Wow, those are all non-enterprise accounts. What do I do here now? I don't want to deal with that.
That's awful.
And you've got mobile, and the internet of things. You know, everyone now wants to have a certain suite of applications and services on their mobile device. You've given employees an iPad or some other tablet or the phone, obviously. You've got to deal with that enterprise in a way that's scalable and manageable, yada, yada. The lifecycle management is a big piece of this for those employees and people. You bring them on in a particular department, they've got a particular band of that stuff. You know, you wouldn't be saying, hey, the guy that's there and puts the cars together, they don't need to put a Twitter account. It's like provision when they come on the floor. They don't need that. But they need these other things. Payroll, benefits,
benefits, time cards, all that stuff.
They don't need sales force on Twitter.
I've got to have some way to manage that.
This person has this policy model.
They get this stuff, the other person doesn't.
Having people
manage that at a help desk individually, eventually on the phone,
that won't scale.
That's awful.
I'll have some way
from your provision division user.
Someone says, okay, this is this kind of person. Let's get
services and features that they need without having to make an entirely manual process.
So what is it that IBM is offering here? Well, we've got a lot of that stuff ready for you. Cloud Native Service Provider, a way to acquire any access to technologies.
We've got a multi-tenant service offered from the internet, public cloud.
And it's based on IBM's suite of tools and products.
I've got an access manager, policy manager. You've got
Provisioning, Federation.
All these.
But of course, again, we talked about earlier.
You want to buy all those pieces, do all the work yourself.
You say, hey, we already built that economy of scale there.
We'll put you in a silo over here.
A lot of shared infrastructure, protected space in it.
And you can leverage that economy of scale.
The capabilities, comprehensive capabilities there for it.
We built that whole suite of IBM products.
And there are a lot of them previously called Tivoli, and some of you may be familiar, some of you not.
There's a lot of functionality there.
So key statistics there, we've got over 14 million users.
Currently deployed across different companies and clients.
57 countries of origin.
And millions of transactions.
Some of it's business to consumer.
Just within the enterprise. As I mentioned, rattle through that user provisioning.
These are lifecycle management. Self-service is a big one.
You may or may not have.
On the internet.
I want a reset password. I can't be sending an email or calling somebody, asking them to do it once I get mine. That's the only way.
But you like to ask questions about themselves.
And manage their own passwords.
And other stuff like that, different services that they might need. And one of the big pieces that I've worked over the last decade plus is single sign-on on these different web applications. Even the things that are on premise.
There's that big shared interface with the application through the browser, through the web. And then you've got this disparate accounts across a very large number of databases and directories.
And people don't keep track of that.
Again, that just compounds your problems.
When you use single sign-on and federation between the two systems, you can use their enterprise login desktop.
And then depending on how that access is defined for different applications,
when they go into the browser, they can get the app to sign on.
Go to the next app to sign on again.
On through the next five or ten apps.
And you can imagine that it's payroll. Time cards, you name it, the sales force stuff, and the sales people have to do.
And of course, the access control policy. For some of those, you want strong authentication.
For some apps, you want somebody to have a token, a dongle. You want them to have a passcode to come in.
Something very important, two-factor, multi-factor.
You'd be able to do that. So.
One nice thing about this presentation is it mentions the client. I work with the consultant technical team for a Fortune 10 client.
Strategic business consumer solution, customer facing on the web. It's a large auto manufacturer. I'm not going to tell you which one. You can guess there are probably only that one.
But anyway, we've got over 8.5 million users.
That are out there. Someone goes to one of those sites. One of the suite of products, brands, company has. Those users are all hosted in a directory on the cloud that we support. And we also got some union workers there. There's 50,000 to manage their own identities.
Self-service, password, and other pieces there.
They get to a federation solution.
And it's really cool.
I really enjoy working with IBM and the strategic team. They're bringing more and more applications mobile around the world. Big markets like China, other places where this thing is rapidly expanding, the tip of the iceberg, the number of users the company will see and bring on board. So, just said,
the previous business challenge for them was
you know, the silos app that says, hey, the mobile app, you can log in, and then the main web app, if you want to be a service for my car, that was a different app, and
maybe it was synchronized, but it wasn't handled well.
Okay, when I reset my password, where do I go?
If I was over here in the get service for my car,
does that mean that I go over the sales side? I didn't know what I did in this other app.
Obviously trying to deal with that.
We provided solutions that you could have a unified system and one entity that worked across the roster of websites and browser properties.
Yeah, there's. But there are two.
Okay, you can vote the coin. You said the simplified mobile experience and web experience for the your end user, and these are the outbound.
That's a really nice thing. The person wants to go out and
buy a truck or a car, and goes out and looks at just the main site of a sales application.
They do not want to deal with the hassle. Wait,
why can't I
Facebook?
You said
why does my business over here?
Where at the car, I was prepping out and taking features for where that go? You know, I log in way over here, like log in
Twitter.
You've got to have a modern web-based sales-facing organization. You've got to have a seamless user. They expect as good as it is. Very, very much. Google's and Twitter's, Facebook's, everything else.
Anywhere
to do that login. That's what users demand. Which, again, could be very challenging. Because,
keeping up
the cutting edge is not easy.
So we've got that simplified mobile
experience, tying with the web experience.
Personalized
experience, which is very cool. We have tie-in with
user profile
information. If you bought a car, and so that's one data point. To have that simple authentication account where that's tied in, the user doesn't have to deal with
any worries
about how long I'm going to get my profile. That's much easier to centralize directory accounts.
So as we mentioned,
got
Governance self-service
for the user stuff. Where user stuff services, reset passwords, and so forth. The product again is multi-tenant. And that's really lots of different people running on that infrastructure, data centers. The platform software that's new. Data center technology that IBM's got. I know less about it other than that it's going around worldwide rapidly being deployed and adopted. And some of the things we're able to do with disaster recovery and multi-site and global work is going to really
be helped by
software. Because in the older days, we've got. It's much easier to do technology. But I never know very about it because I'm not on the network operations side. I'm in the application security side.
Wow, all that text. I don't think I'm going to read all that.
Maybe we'll put this out there for you guys to. I've talked about a lot of it already. There's a lot of rewarding features in here. I haven't seen some products built in there. Web administrative interface. Is it 100+ auto types built in there? Control down. Schedule reports. Real-time events. See what happened here with this user's calls.
One of the neat things we'll talk about here is
a very large number of application and protocol connections. There's some others out there coming. Commodity with the Salesforce and the Workday times of the world. As more and more things go to a serverless web, and more and more adopt the federation, a decade took a lot of tinkering, some coding, and effort to get applications federated. It generally worked easily, two of them. And now you almost have a clinic where you say, hey, I want federation. Salesforce has this pattern. Everybody knows how to do it. I want to sell off their stuff.
It should almost
be almost clinic administrators.
And with the new features we've got, it is.
One thing that's right now, if a company wants to have their own code for provisioning, user management. User authentication, they want their own software, the web-based, we can do a lot of work with that REST API.
It's pretty cool.
And the customer I'm working with is leveraging the web and that API for a lot of the work. The mobile stuff. Imagine about a REST API, not a browser, mobile app. It's coded in not in a browser, a native language for the mobile device. So that's
he's talking about that. What we
You've got use cases here, user and niche, and social, and yes, there's application, like Salesforce, they want. You've got self-service applications that are presented in the web layer. And all this is tied together. You see here. Basically, protected from the enterprise piece. This also provides access lists, policies, roles that the user has. That's some management that's centrally. It's been a big help for some of the clients that I've worked with. There was no policy easily in some of the cloud services. And we've got a great solution for that. We talked about this. I don't know if you guys can get to see many use cases. This has got some stuff on provisioning. So maybe this is what I'm talking about. You guys want to talk about that?
A lot of the user lifecycle, you end up with a certain user mindset,
and it might involve some active directory. There may be some other cloud directory I need to provision to. And of course, you have a centralized directory that you've got dialed up and put in one place and get access to the others.
Trying to get all those attributes
and user data. Extracted, put in that force you need, pushed up into that database challenge. And one of the features the product is use feed the API and message queue when an event happens back on site. And we'll go through the VPN for the push up to our system and say, hey, we updated such and such via the HR process. And now I need to update address or some other thing about them. And that's an advantage they understand that maybe hard to do is purely web-based and couldn't connect with that API.
Again,
self-registration, users, password set. That's important.
Username recovery.
If they've somehow forgotten their username. I don't think that happens very much, but I guess that's a feature that
is important.
You see that web apps where I signed up with. I think the last common interface would be the
user face
or internet customer probably more important. And I've talked some talks about that self-service portals, more management, profile, delegated administration, yada. Yeah, point-and-click configuration in there. Again, that's pretty neat.
Previous versions of the application,
there was a lot of non-click stuff you have to do. A lot of configuration files. Team working on the development is all good job and making it something that...
Okay,
you're and if the user management is not the top line, they can figure out what they need here, rather than having it in XML.
And we do offer you
branding content, logic experience there, so you can get basically looking at one looks like your brand, your brand,
here's a lovely shot.
All their information. Customize those fields to what you want.
And then
we'll talk about importing. They can do that.
Hey, look.
You can get a pie chart. We got pie charts. People. What is it?
Success, failure, patient. I sure hope there's not.
Majority of the implementation with failures, user base. That's sounds like awesome.
It's funny, they all thought they were an administrator. Last night, they just logged in a million and a half times.
And this morning, it all stopped. And it was just one of them.
All right, so this piece,
the web administration piece,
get to
either over web or VPN if you wanted to.
We called it GMA
or manager administration. That was the core piece that administrators use.
Not that probably to talk about.
That self-service you saw. Screener 2 is written to Java. And you can do a lot of stuff with that. It's very customizable.
And very scalable,
level of scale we can accomplish.
Much better than
Firefox. become possible.
Pick the part you want.
and through and saying, hey, hey, own your properties.
Step three,
make sure you get it right. And ta-da.
Another thing that's been a big challenge
is you may help with certificates for PKI,
especially with SSSI,
Federation, relies on those cloud certificates. I've talked about them in the presentation. And managing those can be immediate. If you have to do that, manually and move files around and act in those certificates.
It's a huge
thing. The more of those federations you get, which has a pair of certificates with it. And so for that web of federations,
you end up with
okay, a number of things are going to expire. I've got to track them. You're doing it manually with various types of stores.
It definitely
should be a challenge.
So there's a nice configure here.
You can go in and
manage those certificates. And here is a massive list of corporate models.
Or some of the other providers out there that do some federation stuff. There's probably Octa, and a few others that provide some of my services. Obviously, that's a direct interface with all these parties.
That's a really big list.
And getting bigger and bigger. Again, I'm very impressed with what you're able to do. But there's a little bit of work to help them up when they started.
Briefly,
the next thing I know, so that Scott's got
this. So my role
within the organization as a consultant
is helping to
do the consultation, design architecture, and help with integration, custom customization, and coding with a team
for a client.
And the only thing we have in our hand is
a lot of the hand-holding, high-touch
there, consultations,
all the stuff.
Right here for a big, large organization, it's still very, very close, no matter how much I try to
do. Look how simple it is. It takes a demand by environment. This is awesome. For an enterprise,
that's a complex IT beast. And so they do need that level of consultant assistance and advice and design.
We would not expect somebody to come in and
just... Just start. That won't be a success. So we've got
multiple phases here.
Sure.
Love you through.
Anyway,
you've got projects already starting, planning,
solution design,
configuration,
deployment,
and then as we
end up from my services, consulting.
Once we get everything
going, the client wants it
going,
hand it over to the managed services operations department behind IBM. So but I don't have to administer it day to day.
Thank you.
That's good.
So is there all those hardware issues that are
It's pretty straightforward.
We could talk about pricing, but again,
there's a minimum number of users they should want in order to use the service the way it is today. Because there is a certain hurdle to get over. There's a cost per user subscription.
An initial cost to set it up.
So there's
50 people aren't going to use it.
There's a number there.
Now for the partner, like Salesforce.
Sure.
They'll let you do five. And you can do Google Drive and some stuff, or Office 365 with two people if you had a two-person coach in the company.
So for those extra partners.
We are in pricing.
I'm not. I'll get in trouble if I say anything. Not my department.
I am not authorized to talk about that.
So it looks like we want a three-year subscription
to get you started.
99% of our time, all the time.
And that's a minimum SLA. And
you've got that operations center
and help all this process from IBM.
It goes much more than just
this product line. If you add IBM, whether it's
shared mainframe,
other stuff, that same operations center, support center, you're calling to, the same thing, even router place here. So you've got that kind of operations,
maintenance, yada, terms of the investment point, the economies of scale, the savings is that you're not paying for software license stuff and logging that hosted or on-premise. The cost of subscription obviously covers the cost of software licenses. The professional services that's me. That vary a lot. How much for some of the clients they need very little. We talked to one recently. It's like, just set it up. We want as little help as you can give us, make sure that we're working ourselves. Which is great.
We find them in that large manufacturer.
Because of the size and scope of what they're doing. There are constantly things that need professional services, and that's what you expect with a company that big.
We can't really expect each team to know what the other team would do.
And there you go. The subscription fee is based on the user's, and I don't know what the
what those numbers are down to be. I'm sure some sales would be happy to talk to you about that. Very happy. So let's see here.
Gartner really likes our stuff.
We're up in the good part for this. The products we make, those prognostications about the value of such services.
Said market technologies, the individual software components that I've come from, their suite of tools.
This stuff is very mature, lots of iteration improvements. Very good stuff.
And for the on-premise stuff, you just have components.
I don't even know how many users are using it on-premise. I didn't look up the number, but a lot of users are using that Tivoli suite. It's got the new ISAM stuff for the names.
Okay, ranked from 50 for IBM, which is true, that's awesome.
You can see them because they got me, they're even more awesome now than they were, it was already really cool.
So we say no other offer on the market, the breadth of capabilities. I'm sure any salesperson will tell you that.
But I think that's really true.
The breadth of services we can offer in this plan is amazing.
I haven't seen someone come up with something and say, do this.
No, there's no way to do that. It never comes up. There's a way to do it. It's not from scratch, because all those different tools. Someone's asked those questions for years.
And the pieces are already there.
So, at a certain point in the past, I thought the cloud was bad.
People wouldn't be doing that.
Changed my mind. I was wrong. But that was expected.
That was ages and ages ago when I put everything on the internet. And it just didn't seem like that was a good way to go.
It turns out there is a lowering of ownership this way.
That seems obvious to me now. Not a decade ago.
As I mentioned, getting a presentation. One of the big pieces is reducing the score, which you don't have to have some news.
Those complex products in and out, on site, working for you.
We're there to destroy jobs in the organization.
That's what I'm here to do.
All right.
Yada, yada, yada. You're going to read that.
And thank you.
Thank you for letting me.
Come tell you about my department and IBM's offering. Do you have questions?
Yes.
Somebody has questions.
Good.
I can.
IBM's LDAP offering users natural directory. And so I want a particular password string complexity. You got that in the wrong product, so you got to match your enterprise requirements. Password hashed in IBM's directory server. They're done that way. Basically, strong as you want to make it, there's not a limit on how much you want on your users.
So, other things you said, as far as vulnerability, that is not my area of work.
I do know from serving and doing that very quickly, the internet aspects of this, to patch, update, and we find a problem.
But I can't speak to what their strategies are for that.
I don't handle that.
I can certainly give feedback to my manager and director, but I know what I'm saying, hey, heard this from someone in a large enterprise, what can we say in the presentation, it's not fair about how we address it.
I would say, if you had questions, I would move into this, I would say, 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 I would say
That's tough. That's tough. Tough crowd. Going once, going twice.
You almost have all of that.
If you do have a question, talk to me, not on the stream.
Of course.
Most of you guys just come after me for the details.
If you don't know, there's somebody on it. I can go look it up.
Thank you for your time.